What's the word, y'all? Welcome back to NBA Every Day. We're not going to talk about the fact, or I guess we will talk about it. I haven't uploaded the Every Day series in the last 2 days, but there's a legitimate reason for that. I usually don't quote or talk about things like this, but like on national TV, I've seen some crazy stuff over the last couple days. Well, because they're on national TV and they have to talk on TV for an hour or 2 hours, they're forcing out content. I saw a clip of two people not talking about 2K ratings, but talking about LeBron talking about 2K ratings. I will never come onto this channel and force a video out because I need to fill time. So if I go 2 days and I upload it, just know that the video, once we come back, is going to be a banger. And that's the day. I want to talk about the New York Knicks. I also got a fly in here, so, you know. So if you see abrupt stops, that's because I'm trying to get that fly. But just everything matches the room. It's kind of fire. Nobody expected the New York Knicks to be a good team last year. Nobody at all. The surprising story of the NBA was the New York Knicks. And if you're about to type Kenny, I knew that the Knicks were about to be not just a playoff team, but the fourth seed. You're literally lying to me, bro. Because if you knew that, you would have put some money on it. You'd be walking out of here a lot richer. Because Vegas didn't even expect the Knicks to even sniff a playoff spot. I think they over-under was like 20-something games. And here they were with home court advantage in the first round of the playoffs. Yes, they got eliminated. Yada, yada, yada. We're not talking about that. They had home court advantage in the first round of the playoffs out of nowhere. And we're going to talk about some of those things and why, low-key, I am envious of what they're doing over there. Let's start off with giving the roses to Leon Rose. I didn't even think about that until it actually came to the... Giving the roses to Leon Rose, because before he came into office, before he came into power with the New York Knicks, the Knicks had been the laughing stock of the league for 5 years, maybe, or however many years. Bad signings, lack of signings, missed draft picks, yada, 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 yada. And Leon Rose came into office. You know what's coming to mind, bro? You know what it reminds me of? And the only reason I'm thinking about this because I just watched this movie for the 10th time a couple days ago. It reminds me of Moneyball. I'm sure a lot of y'all have seen Moneyball. It's the movie with Jonah Hill and Brad Pitt. It's based on baseball, the Oakland Athletics building the team, yada, yada, yada. The team went on to win 20-plus games. But the reason it reminds me of that, because the team that Leon Rose built last season feels like Jonah Hill's character going through the computer, looking at advanced stats, trying to put together the puzzle pieces to not spend a lot of money, but also be a good team. So, Reggie Bullock on his last team shot 40-something percent on catch and shoots. We could probably get him for $10 million. Julius Randle just put up good statistics on the previous season, but he ain't never had a good coach, so let's get him a good coach. You know, Nerlens Noel was one of the top picks in the draft and never fulfilled that, but last year when he was in OKC, he was pretty solid as a backup. Let's got to give him a starting spot. Like, I feel like that's what Leon Rose and his team was really doing, and low-key put it together a competent enough roster to make a push. We gonna trade for a dude that's beloved across the league, won an MVP when he was younger, but ain't really been it for the last couple years. Derrick Rose has a resurgence of a career. I just think it's good for basketball when good big market teams are good. Just think about how much buzz the city of New York had. And that was during a pandemic. Imagine if everything was opened up while the Knicks were doing what they were doing and how crazy New York would have been. They were crazy during a pandemic, y'all. They're in the streets on top of telephone poles because they won a game on national TV. Because they clinched the playoff spot. You know what I'm saying? I just can't imagine. Like, New York Knicks fans have been through a lot. Because even in the down years or you're starting absolute scrubs, the Garden was popping. Like, I had been to multiple games in New York when the team was really bad. Where Emmanuel Mudiay was hitting the game winner. The game I went to, he had a game winner. But Emmanuel Mudiay was, like, the best player on the New York Knicks, like, just 3 years ago. And here they are without, like, having a superstar come to the team. Without hitting a home run on a draft pick. They have become a very competent team that was the four seed. And that was basically just role players and a player that turned into the most improved player. Then this offseason came around. And this offseason was not one with big name free agents. We had Kawhi Leonard who re-signed. We had a couple different names that were all-stars in the past or people project to be maybe future all-stars unrestricted. But this was not a big free agency class. So what did Leon Rose and his front office do? They brought back the guys that got them to the four seed on very solid contracts. I saw a lot of people upset with some of the extensions that they gave out. I didn't see any of them that I was like, ooh, that's a bad contract. And then they brought in players that can help them. One of the reasons why they flamed out in the playoffs was Julius Randle struggled in the playoffs because it was just him for the most part. You had some RJ things. We're going to talk about RJ in a little bit. But it was just like, we can focus in on Julius Randle because he is the focal point of their offense. And what did they do? They went out and get Evan Fournier. Evan Fournier can create for himself and for his other teammates. That's a W. And the one that I don't think anybody saw coming, Kemba Walker going home in the Garden. My one memory of him is crossing up the Gown Pit. And now he's back there. And I know the last couple of seasons for Kemba Walker haven't necessarily been a super healthy run. Specifically last year wasn't even a good run, but in 2020, he was an all-star starter. It's not too far removed that he was an all-star starter. I was in the press room after that all-star game. He had this big old green coat on. And my boy Mike, he walked past us. And Mike was like, that coat go crazy, Kemba. He's like, thank you. That's what happens when you put 24-year-olds in a room with a bunch of old reporters and stuff. I don't know. So I'm not saying we about to get Kemba Walker that was an all-star starter a couple years ago. But if you can get 65% of the Kemba Walker that we seen 2 years ago, one hell of a pickup. It's not like you paying him the money that Kemba Walker was guaranteed. OKC bought him out. And that was another thing. OKC was like trying to facilitate a deal to end them there, like giving up some picks. Leon Rose and them give up some picks to make this deal happen. And Leon Rose stood put. There's no pressure on us because if we don't get Kemba, we're still going to be good. So he forced the hand of Sam Presti to buy out the last 2 years of his contract, which was crazy. I'd never expected Sam Presti to be a guy to buy out a contract. He's always seems like a dude, you're going to stay here for 2 months and then we go trade you. Like Derek Favors is there right now. What's the word on Derek Favors right now? He might turn into a first round pick by the end of the first half of the season. So Kemba Walker coming in on a 2 years, what is it, like $10 million contract. It is a ridiculously good thing. Because even if he is bad, no big deal. It's just no big deal. It's really no big deal. You still have Derrick Rose, who was a six-man of the year candidate. You still got Emmanuel Quickley, who should be getting better. And you look at the summer league things, he was playing really solidly. Just overall, I think that their offseason was a huge W. And Leon Rose is not all hits and no misses. I mean, it's too early to tell, but nobody expected Julius Randle to be the most improved player. So the Obi Toppin pick kind of looks weird now. Because he's basically a guaranteed backup for the foreseeable future since they extended Julius Randle. And they had like Tyrese Halliburton down there. Devin Vassell was selected after Obi Toppin. These are all players that could probably help you a little bit more right now. But again, nobody's batting 100. And then you got this year's draft, which in the moment was very confusing for me because they had two draft picks in the end of the, or the, after the lottery, I think it was 19 and 21 or something like that. And they continued to trade back. And what had happened was they had guys like Trey Murphy who got selected before. They had like three guys on their big board that all got selected right before their pick. So what did they do? They had another part of their big board that was supposed to be later first round. Why use our pick right now? We could give some future assets. So they still had guys like Quentin Grimes that they really wanted, but they didn't have to use the 19th overall pick for that, and they got future assets. Even though I think one of those future assets is like a heavily protected first round pick, it's still better than nothing. And I think the best thing about what Leon Rose has been doing so far is his patience. Because again, he could have selected Quentin Grimes at 19, or he could have listened to his offers. He could have traded for Kemba Walker's big old contract because they had the space to bring in Kemba Walker. Nah, we just going to wait. We're going to let you do your thing and we just going to take advantage once you make the decision. And those type of things are super valuable. And it's one of the reasons why I said in the beginning of the video that I'm low-key envious of what the New York Knicks got going on, because the Chicago Bulls have done the exact opposite. I'm not saying there's a right or there's a wrong, but my Chicago Bulls are a significantly better basketball team right now. But in order to do that, we gave up a lot. We were hyper-aggressive, which again, I'm not saying there's a right or a wrong, while Leon Rose was kind of very passive with his moves, you know? And that him being passive sets them up very solidly for a future star if they wanted out and wanted to go to New York. All of the contracts he signed this offseason are very tradable in a big-time package. Those Porzingis picks, very tradable. Their own picks, very tradable if a superstar player decides, hey, I think New York basketball is back and I want to go play there. And I can't say the same thing about the Bulls because we traded all of our like future assets for the most part to get the core that we have now. Again, there's no right or wrong, but I'm low-key envious of the possibilities that can happen with the Knicks. Well, with the Chicago Bulls, we kind of have an understanding of the next couple years. I just keep thinking about Kemba Walker and the Knicks. Like the Knicks point guard position is like the Chicago Bears quarterback position. The boys ain't never had no like super good competent player at that position, at least in the recent past. And Kemba Walker will come in and be the best point guard they had in a long time, in a very long time. And maybe Justin Fields will come into Chicago and be the best quarterback that they've had in a very long time. I'm excited about that, even though I'm not necessarily a football fan. So what's next for the Chicago Bulls this season? I said this on our podcast. I would not be surprised if the New York Knicks are a worse team this year when it comes to their overall record, but still a good team, because I think teams kind of understand what they're going for. And I do believe there's more competent teams in the Eastern Conference and in the Western Conference that will put up more of a fight than last year. Right? I'm expecting a better season from RJ Barrett. He had a very good one. I think he shot 40% from three. I still think there's all-star potential there. But again, I wouldn't be surprised if they were the 16 instead of the 4 seed. Does that mean they are a worse team? Not necessarily. That just also means that there are teams around them that got better. And I also like the fact that they bring back guys that mean a lot to them. Taj Gibson is an okay player. You could replace Taj Gibson's minutes. But they're like, nah, Taj is a Thibs guy. Taj is a locker room dude, so we gonna get our, how old is Taj Gibson nowadays? 34, 35? We're gonna give him a 2-year extension. Sure, it's money, but hey, if he can teach Obi Toppin how to get some more offensive rebounds, it's worth the extra money that we gave to Taj, and I don't think there's a lot of organizations doing stuff like that. Anyway, that's all I gotta say about the New York Knicks. Let me know what you think about their offseason or their upcoming season. What do you expect from New York Knicks? Knicks fans, how does it feel to be back? Hopefully I get the same feeling you got last year, this year, or my Bulls. Who knows?